Welcome back to Let's Play Cyberpunk 2077 Blind. I'm Amethyst Lunatari. We're here in Memorial Park Station. Just completed the quest serial something or other. We're gonna be reading. We're gonna be reading through the codex or whatever entries. We just finished Serial Suicide. Memorial Park Station. So we're still there. I mean, this is a nice, quiet place. I can't sit, but we'll stand by a seat. And we'll read through these entries. So if you guys don't want to... hear me reading through all this stuff, then sorry. Skip this episode. I might be splitting into several episodes, though. There's a lot to read. Some of the entries aren't that brief. Database, that's what it is. So, we're skipping vehicles and all the... what do you call it? The... for lack of a better term... yeah, the tutorial type stuff. Telling you how to sneak and stuff, because that'd be stupid to read this. But, you know, just about the world and weapons and characters and stuff. Locations. Look at that thing. So pink. Budget arms slot-o-matic. Knight citizens agree on a lot, but there's one common platform they share. A gun should be available to everyone, no matter the thickness of their wallet, their age, their criminal history, the time of day, and most importantly, no questions asked. The Slot-O-Matic is the real-life manifestation of that philosophy, if you can call it that. You can buy this single-use pistol from most vending machines for a price not much higher than a can of Nicola. At first glance, you can clearly see why. It's made from the cheapest plastic, liable to not only melt if left out in the sun, but also prone to jamming, breaking, and snapping inexperienced wrists with its high recoil. Still, a gun's primary purpose is to kill, and that's what it does. But when you've fired the last round, don't bother reloading it. Don't bother reloading, just toss it in the trash and buy a new one. Arasaka HJKE11 Yukimura. Back in the day, soldiers had to go through weeks of combat training. Crazy, right? Nowadays, smart guns can automatically lock onto targets and fire homing rounds. All you need are the right implants. It was a pistol that started the smart revolution. The Yukimura, issued in the 2040s by Arasaka. With the Yukimura, you could shoot as poorly as the robots in a certain late 20th century epic space opera, Stormtroopers, and still hit your target with 100% accuracy. Even now, over 30 years later, the Yukimura is still considered one of the best handguns ever made. It boasts two firing modes, automatic and three-round burst that allows its users to adapt to the situation, as well as the ample magazine for prolonged firefights. Arasaka JKE X2 Kenshin. This simple, unpretentious pistol is the pride and joy of Arasaka's engineers. Kenshin is one of the most cutting-edge and deadliest machine pistols available on the market. Harness the power of lightning. The Kenshin's brute power first comes from generating electromagnetic tension before releasing a lethal tungsten-tipped round that could penetrate the sturdiest armor. Like other guns of this class, it comes ready equipped with a holographic scope. You know what I'm actually going to do now? I'm thinking of it. I'm going to put timestamps for the categories, weapons. So if you guys want to just skip to world, you can just click a timestamp. Kang Tao A22B Chow. The smart gun market used to be an Arasaka-only affair, but that all changed when Kang Tao stepped in. The A22B Chow... did I say 228? 22B Chow is the Chinese answer to Arasaka's Yukimura. As the gossip goes, both guns may have been designed by the same engineer, extracted from the Japanese corp on Kang Tao's orders. Whatever the case may be, you can be sure that the A22B Chow is easy to use and reload. Once the last cartridge is used, the empty magazine is automatically discharged. Easy to use, practical, unless the empty mag hits an unsuspecting shooter in the foot. That is. Tsunami New. Oh, I've seen so many of these. Tsunami Defense Systems is known best for its elite and dizzyingly expensive sniper rifles, but more of the Japanese company's products are beginning to gain traction on Night City streets. Take their flagship pistol, the New, for example. Unlike the Ashura or Nekomata, the New's design is not founded on any bleeding-edge technologies, but what it lacks in innovation, it makes up for in workmanship. Elegant, reliable, and deadly, the New is the unchallenged leader of the pistol market. The only debatable flaw is a size that can prove difficult to conceal. Still, who would ever want to hide such a masterpiece? Militech M76E Omaha. The Omaha looks like your classic lead spitter, but don't let appearances fool you. This gem from Militech conceals its powerful electromag rail system, which launches solid metal projectiles instead of firing ordinary pistol rounds. With each pull of the trigger, the Omaha quietly slings out three projectiles with tremendous force behind them. It's no wonder this firearm is commonly found in the holsters of corpos at the high end of the food chain. Its small size makes it a convenient fit in a briefcase or inside the company limo's glove compartment. And when the situation gets hot, the Omaha proves no less lethal than a heavy machine gun in the right hands. Malorian Overture. A 42 caliber six-shot semi-automatic double-action power-class revolver crafted with the classic Malorian traits. Heavy, reliable, and packed with firepower. Although Malorian has been faring worse on the market than its competitors in recent years, the Overture is still an iconic, high-quality weapon that can be found on the streets. Tektronica RT-46 Buria. The Buria belongs in a museum as a benchmark for Soviet design. Is it pretty to look at? No. Convenient to use? Nope. Safe? Nuh-uh. But effective? Absolutely. The RT-46 is an electromag pistol that can blast through walls and is practically as dense as a neutron star. Somehow I doubt that. To use it and survive, advanced musculoskeletal cyberware is advised. But even if someone without the recommended implants does manage to lift the Buria, pulling the trigger would almost guarantee a broken elbow. Dara Polytechnic DR5 Nova. The Nova is a traditional revolver that offers substantial firepower at a reasonable price. Its classic cylinder harkens back to the times of the Wild West, and while the Nova is prone to failure, it's also easy to fix thanks to its simple design and construction. It can be found in NCPD weapon lockers, in small-time corporate arsenals, tucked in the belts of gang goons, and stowed in women's handbags. In other words, everyone uses it. Militech Crusher. The very sight of the Militech Crusher is enough to bring a tear to any gun lover's eye. This powerful shotgun, designed for short-range combat, was first created in the year 2020, soon becoming one of the period's iconic weapons. The version currently available on the market has seen some updates from the original, including a new modern sight, but its distinctive look remains the same. Once standard issue among corporate guards, today the Crusher is more popular among mercs with a nostalgic streak. Drink. Dara Polytechnic DR-12 Quasar. The Quasar is perhaps the most distinctive weapon. That's interesting looking. You can find in Night City. It features an unusual angular frame, classic disc magazine, and one-of-a-kind technology. After all, the Quasar is an electromagnetic gun. The barrel holds four electrically charged shafts, which in combination with the bullet form opposing electromagnetic poles. The resulting forces release the bullet at lightning speed. A shot from the unassuming Quasar can even pierce armored vehicles and bulletproof vests. Nokota D5 Copperhead. Once upon a time, in the second half of the 20th century, the world's most popular assault rifle was the AK-47, also commonly known as the Kalashnikov, in honor of its inventor. Today these rifles can only be found in museums, as their market niche was replaced by the Nokota Copperhead. The mass-produced assault rifle sticks to the basics of functionality and reliability. There's no finesse or ingenuity to fall in love with, but many people find its dependable stopping power an endearing trait. Lakota D5 Sidewinder. The Sidewinder is the younger but wiser brother to the Copperhead. Based on the same frame, Lakota engineers finally crafted their own smart class rifle. But to say this gun is truly smart is a certain overreach. The Sidewinder doesn't try to hide what it is, and it's clear it can't stand toe-to-toe with its counterparts from Arasaka, Militech, and Kang Tao. Yes, it offers aim assist, yes, it aids in battlefield orientation, but anyone who's ever wielded a true top-shelf smart rifle can tell you the difference in quality is obvious. Still, despite its competitive shortcomings, the Sidewinder and its approachable price tag have chiseled out a stable niche for Nakoda in the smart weaponry market. Militech M251S Ajax. In less turbulent times, the name Ajax would more likely be associated with the Greek hero of legend, a European soccer club, or a household cleaning product. For the residents of Night City, Ajax brings to mind only one thing, Militech's assault rifle. Its engineers made no attempt to reinvent the wheel, but only to design a durable, reliable weapon that wouldn't require months of training or high-end combat cyberware to use it. Ultimately, the engineers' vision has been realized. Their creation has become the assault of choice for soldiers across the globe. Midnight Arms, SOR-22. This powerful semi-automatic assault rifle was used by both sides in the Metal Wars. Designed for military use, the SOR-22 won't offer you any bells or whistles, much less flashy style or user-friendly design. The awkwardly angular, heavy rifle is built for screwing stuff up, and to do so, you're going to need a good endoskeleton and muscle weave. But the gun more than makes up for any inconvenience with its sheer firepower and reliability. The SOR-22 is rare on the streets of Night City, and it always spells trouble. Tsunami Necromata. The Necromata is a demanding weapon. It requires care, regular service, and time to learn how best to use it. But it's worth it. Really, really worth it. This electromag sniper rifle is a technological marvel. The tungsten spike it launches can pierce the thickest armor and walls and shatter titanium bones. No one is safe from the Necromata's destructive force, and which is why the sale of this rifle is strictly regulated. It's almost impossible for mercenaries outside the employ of a government or major megacorp to get their hands on one. Almost. Tektronica SPT-32 Grad. Around the turn of the 21st century, the arms industry faced a pressing challenge. Many popular sniper rifles were increasingly proving ineffective against people heavily modified with cyberware. A shot that would once kill an ordinary person now only makes a dent. The world required a new generation of sniper rifles. The first of this new wave was the Soviet-made SPT-32 Grad, considered by many to be the most powerful sniper on the market. It may not possess the same dedication to detail as its counterparts from Arasaka or Militech, but in the hands of a well-trained sharpshooter who doesn't rely on weapon-assisted wind readings, the Grad is a true devastating force. No wall will stop it from hitting its target. Many more. Constitutional Arms M2038 Tactician. You meet plenty of these in Night City. Chances are even your next-door neighbor keeps one under their couch just in case. In spite of its age, it's still used by the NCPD, as well as a number of gangs. It's not hard to see why the Tactician is so widely admired. It's a cheap, simple, and user-friendly weapon that can also deal an impressive amount of damage. Additional features? None. Sometimes simpler is better. Why have tagliatelle a la truffee when you can have mac and cheese? Rostovik DB2 Satara. The Satara is an unusual breed, both because of its bizarre appearance and its unconventional technological foundation. Instead of firing ordinary buckshot, this electromag shotgun launches small, razor-sharp steel spikes. Critics argue that Satara heaviness and bulkiness make it unreasonably inconvenient for practical use. Its advocates, however, point out that the Serbian shotgun is undeterred by walls. MAXTAC officers belong to the latter group. After many trials in the field, the Satara has proved consistently effective at bringing down even the most heavily chromed cyber psychos. Rostovik DB4 Igla. Fun fact, the Igla was conceived at the beginning of the 21st century as a hunting weapon. Specifically, it was engineered to hunt ducks, medium-sized waterfowl, somewhat similar to seagulls, now considered extinct. Ducks are extinct? Oh my god. The Igla may have fared well against the ducks of Serbia's swamplands, but in 2077's Night City, this shotgun is considered an antique that not even the city's poor and desperate are willing to resort to. Many complain that it produces more noise than damage. Rostovik DB4 Palica? The mines at Serbia-based Rostovik set out to prove that smart doesn't have to mean expensive. The fruit of their endeavor is the Palica, based on their time-tested Igla model. Was the experiment a success? Opinions are divided. The Palica's price is certainly lower than the competition, but it also has the craftsmanship to match. This shotgun possesses the basic functionality of a smart class shotgun, but it's not worth the breath required to compare it to Arasaka or Tsunami weapons. Still, for those whose wallets are already squeezed, the Palica really is the smart choice. Militech M221 Saratoga. Everyone in Night City knows the characteristic rattle of this submachine gun. Designed in the 2040s, Militech intended the Saratoga to be a versatile piece in their corporate security arsenal. I need to proofread this stuff and a lot of the other things in the game. I wonder if the stuff in The Witcher has typos like this. However, it's several undisputed advantages: small frame, lightweight, relatively cheap price, ease of use, and modifiability also rendered this SMG a major hit outside the glass towers of Corpo Plaza. Gangs, in particular, took a liking to it. The SMG is the ideal weapon for vehicular and urban combat, but as the average Joes and Janes gain greater success to the Saratoga, corporate security forces will need to equip themselves with a more powerful deterrent. Which might be the Arasaka TKI-20 Shingen? Japanese culture loves smallness. Just look at the tiny, intricately crafted netsuki, if I'm saying that right, sculptures, or the bonsai trees that fit into flower pots. Shingen, the smart machine pistol made by Arasaka, is a love letter to Japanese passion for miniatures. It's hard to believe that the Shingen's stopping power, magazine size, and numerous technical features fit into such a small body. Throw in ergonomic design, tracing rounds, and fast reload speed, and you're looking at the dream gun of every soldier and mercenary. Dara Polytechnic DS1 Pulsar. You've got to hand it to the designers at Dara. They don't shy away from a little experimentation. The Pulsar looks as if someone first dismantled your typical machine gun, then had a blindfolded kindergartner mash it back together. And yet, there's a method to the madness. Thanks to Dara's unconventional approach, the Pulsar is smaller than most guns of its kind, making it easier to conceal. Unfortunately, originality comes at a price. For all its design flair, the gun's got a killer kickback and is notoriously hard to handle. The quality of its parts also leaves much to be desired. In short, Pulsar is a semi-failed experiment, but for some, its low, low price point makes up for its flaws. You can most often find the Pulsar a weapon of only resort in the slums or tucked snugly in a rookie gangoon's holster. Militech MK31 HMG. The MK31 heavy machine gun was engineered with two core functions in mind. 1. Mounting on armored vehicles. 2. Installing on defensive perimeters. In other words, it was designed as a heavy hitter that was meant to be bolted down. No one inside Militech ever considered anyone could or would want to carry this massive gun anywhere, whether they were loaded with cyberware or not. But, as usual, it seems the human will has found a way. The MK31 HMG can sometimes be found cradled in the arms of heavily chromed solos and gangoons, as they are the only people capable of withstanding the powerful recoil. However, the MK31 cannot be reloaded easily by one person in combat situations, effectively making it a one-hit wonder. Still, this hasn't proved a major drawback for most. By the time its clips is emptied, there's typically no one left to shoot at anyway. True that. I just gotta An itch? Okay. Got it. Okay, we're starting. Yeah, there's only a few more gun entries. Yay. Kang Tao G58 Dian. I think this is going to be like, out of anything, this is going to be the most boring part, is reading about the guns for me anyway. The G58 Dian is one of the top smart guns on the market today. You can spot it in use among even the most elite units, including the trauma team. And no wonder. When you're pulling a victim out of the combat zone, every millisecond counts. There's no time to set up your shot, take a deep breath, and ready aim fire. You just need your lead to hit home. Or your lead to hit home, rather. The G58 Dian recognizes your target and aims right for it, all automatically. You can be sure that even a quick distracted shot will land right where it should. What's more, the fully automated reloading system, ultra-sensitive radar, and top-of-the-line holographic sight make shoot-em-ups a breeze. Still, I mean, a lot of these entries are entertaining, gotta say that much. Kang Tao L69 Zuo. Shotguns aren't exactly known for finesse. While undoubtedly powerful, they often suffer from clunkiness and imprecision. That is, except for the L69 Zuo by Kang Tao. Just like the other weapons manufactured by the Chinese Corp, the L69 Zuo comes packed with top-of-the-line electronics. The ultra-sensitive radar scans the world, the area for you, identifying targets all on its own. And one of the 8 bullets in the below-barrel magazines is always ready and waiting to tear someone to shreds. Constitutional Arms Unity. Unity is often sought after but difficult to achieve. After all, Night City is a city of individualists, anarchists, and warring gangs. In order to unite under a shared banner, you'll need a persuasive argument, preferably cast from lead. The designers at Constitutional Arms responsible for the Unity understood this well. This universal, inexpensive pistol has resolved countless conflicts and put a stop to disputes. Dissatisfied customers, betrayed spouses, impatient drivers stuck in traffic, chances are they'll pull out a Unity. One well-timed shot, and you've won the argument forever. Arasaka Tamayura. One of the oldest weapons made by Arasaka from the early 2000s. These days, it's a rare sight on the street, as it's a pistol that is, no point in sugarcoating it, outdated and difficult to maintain. Spare parts for it are no longer manufactured, and it's no longer compatible with most standard weapon mods. That being said, should it be held up to someone's head and have its trigger pulled, the end result will still be as conclusive as with any modern firearm. I don't know. And finally, the Militech M10 AF Lexington. The preferred pistol among Night City cops. Light, wieldy, and easy on the recoil, it's perfect for taking down enemies without necessarily killing them on the spot. Thanks to its relatively small dimensions, the gun has also found a loyal following among those who prefer a concealed carry. The Lexington easily fits in a coat pocket or purse, and for design lovers, its classic 2030s frame remains stunning as ever. Let's read about the NCPD. The Night City Police Department. The law enforcement this city needs and deserves. Now, they say the best way to know a city is through its police force. The NCPD is an underfunded, under-equipped, understaffed organization where every officer puts their life on the line each day. It's no surprise, then, that most badges in the NCPD have lost faith in their thankless jobs. An atmosphere of apathy and corruption pervades the department, while many officers on the street react with brutality and aggression due to the stress and nature of their work. Nevertheless, some badges still wholeheartedly believe in defending ordinary citizens and making sure the urban jungle doesn't descend into complete chaos. For them, a badge still means something in this city, and a gun is still a tool to protect and serve. Run into one of these zealots, and most gang goons will get on their knees, hands behind their head, refuse, and they're almost certain to get a bullet. Of course, like everywhere else, real power is held in the hands of corporations. The police force's official sponsor is Night Corp, but the NCPD is also beholden to the interests of Arasaka and Militech. Oftentimes, when official investigations get stonewalled, the NCPD will hire mercenaries on the sly to obtain evidence in areas under corporate jurisdiction that forbid any police presence. None of that changes the fact that when people are in trouble, they call the NCPD, who arrive on the scene to protect and serve to the best of their abilities. Sometimes. Drones. Drones are the perfect machines, light, agile, cheap, and ideally suited for exploration. Like almost all modern technologies, they were originally designed in military labs, only enjoying widespread use after entering the global market. Their versatility ensures that any user will find a use for them, from espionage all the way to package deliveries, as simply as a children's toy. Coupled with a Comlink headset, they're perhaps the closest thing some people have to flying. Arisaka Corporation. The Arisaka Corporation is the longest operating megacorp in the world. Its origins date back to the mid-20th century when a young Saburo Arisaka inherited his father's nascent company, transforming it into a global leader in security. Today, the Arisaka Corporation is known as an arms manufacturing giant that has had its hands in military conflicts across all continents. Due to the latest advances in technology and the company's seemingly unlimited capital, Arisaka is poised to achieve its political goals on a massive scale. Arisaka's soldiers and agents are known not only for their excellent training, but also for their steadfast loyalty to corporate values and CEO Saburo Arisaka himself, who, despite his advancing age, he's dead, continues to govern the corporation with an iron fist. Even discussions of a succession plan must be kept to a whisper, because no one would dare openly question the authority of the world's greatest weapons empire. Almost no one. New United States of America, NUSA. The original United States of America, I don't like that flag, divided by bitter internal conflicts and stretched apart by dissident forces, too true, finally collapsed into a potpourri of warring states and sprawling abandoned territories. But when the dust finally settled and disaster became the new normal, the old dreams of unity and national pride were once more united under a new and improved star-spangled banner, behind which stands the new United States of America, NUSA. Rosalind Myers, the union's incumbent president, is hell-bent on bringing the rest of the country in line, no matter the cost. Myers's government, shouldn't be a second S, is supported militarily by Militech, so much so, in fact, it's hard to tell where the state ends and the corporation begins. In that respect, not much has changed. Corporations. In the latter half of the 21st century, corporations are international financial behemoths, mega corporations. They have their own political aims, even waging more or less open conflicts against the competition. It's no exaggeration to say that corporations are what shapes the reality and life of an ordinary person. Just take a look around. Every object in your home came off some production line in a factory belonging to one of the megacorps. Another one delivers electricity to your home so you can watch TV news on a media conglomerate's channel, which in turn has corporations as a majority of its shareholders. Everything you drink, even to a certain extent the air you breathe, it all comes from global concerns. Even if you're blissfully unaware of this, the corporations still influence every aspect of your life. They're at your fingertips. Ah, those fingers are chrome? What manufacturer? Exactly. Fixers. Now, you could take gigs yourself, but when you're hazed once or twice, or get a dose of lead in lieu of payment, you might start looking around for a good fixer. Prove yourself and you'll never have to worry about your next gig again. The fixer will choose your crew, negotiate a decent payout, after all, he or she is taking a cut, and pull you out of whatever crap you might land in on the job. Unless it was your gonk fault, in which case, you're on your own. Fixers are organizers, agents, go-between. They know the latest word on the street, they know who pays right and whose gigs stink from a mile away. Each one has his or her own way of getting things done, but they all follow a certain code of honor. If you work for one, they'll never leave you high and dry. Of course, this code goes both ways. Go ahead, try and haze Wakako Okada or Padre. See what happens. Another drink here. Nomads. The first nomads were farmers forced to leave their land by a series of natural disasters, wars, and corporate machinations. They moved out, gathering in larger and larger groups, hoping to find a better home for their families, but what they saw in their journeys across the states convinced them they were better off staying on the move. Historically, the nomads are divided into seven nations, such as Snake Nation, the Aldecados, and Jades. Jodes? Actually, look like Jodes. Each of which is divided into clans and finally into individual families. Nomads travel with their entire families in series of gainful employment. They rebuilt cities and factories after the collapse, while also playing an important role in creating the maglev network. Some clans take jobs from corporations, seasonal ones of course, so as not to stay too long in one place, while others work for local communities. Nomads value the family and follow their own unique code, which places loyalty to the clan above all else. Scavengers. You can call them grave robbers, were it not for the fact that they never wait for a body to reach the graveyard, nor for it to be actually dead. The scavengers specialize in acquiring high-quality implants by whatever means necessary. If you've got tech that's as expensive as a moderately sized mansion in North Oak, you're asking for trouble. That's why you want to make sure those implants can make themselves useful in a dark, rainy alleyway, or that trauma team will come for you instead of a shady-looking guy with a black bag and a thick Eastern European accent. Ripper Doc. A Ripper Doc lies somewhere between a surgeon, techie, and tattoo artist. If you're lucky, you pay them a visit to get yourself chipped with the latest implant on the market because you can afford it. If you're unlucky, a friend will drop you off at their clinic in pieces and hopefully they can put you back together. People usually have their favorite clinics and trusted rippers that know their bodies better than they do themselves. It's definitely not worth going out on a limb, no pun intended, and looking for the cheapest deal, especially in Little China or past Rancho Coronado, where some jerk will chip you a second or third hand piece of junk with a nasty virus thrown in free of charge. Corps obviously don't have to hunt for the best deals because they have their own corporate rippers. Their high quality services are free, their clinics smell like a hospital ward, and they have the picture perfect smiles of brain dance stars. The whole package. What's not to like? Unless, of course, you don't trust the people you work for enough to let them have access to your brain. It's a smart thing to not trust them. Trauma team. 7 minutes or a refund. That's the trauma team guarantee. The type of guarantee that warms a policyholder's heart as they begin to bleed out in an alley. Warming your heart as you bleed to death. Assuming you haven't lost consciousness from blood loss, don't worry as you count the seconds of life slipping from you. Because help is on the way. First, you'll see a heavily armored AV descend from the sky, using its heavy machine gun turrets to mow down the jerks who are trying to kill you. Then you'll see the medics, your guardian angels, clad in green and white and armed to the teeth. And once the trauma team staff puts you back together, you'll get the bill for your copay. It may have a long list of zeros attached to it, but you'll still sign up for a half-year policy extension with a smile on your lips. Trauma Team provides medical, paramedical, and extraction services in all of the world's major cities. Their services are highly respected and sought after by those who can afford them. In fact, this may be the only corporation that enjoys such a high level of public trust. They don't play politics. They don't ask questions. As long as you pay your dues, your life is safe in their hands, no matter how dire the situation. Netrunners. In 2077, the use of computer technology has become truly universal. Some use a PDA, others personal computers, still others a neural processor. Regular Janes and Joes know how to use these systems to access information, communicate, even fight, but there are others who can use some tech to work wonders, netrunners. A netrunner knows the ins and outs of computer systems, the programming languages, how to write or mod a killer virus. Deck in hand, they're just as dangerous as a corporate soldier armed to the teeth. Many netrunners are free agents working only for themselves, but a few have signed their own pacts with the megacorps and work to keep corporate data fortresses solid and impenetrable. Today, each and every corporation has a veritable army of netrunners on its payroll. Netrunners were once considered the rulers of cyberspace, using their skull jacks to roam a vast global network. That's one thing I really want to see in this game. Going into cyberspace. That'd be awesome. They also needed special suits to cool their bodies, although a tub full of ice would do for penniless punks. But this era ended with the cataclysm wrought by the greatest runner of all, Raish Bartmoss. Oh yeah, that's the guy we found in the freezer. Cyberspace became a land of demons cut off by the nearly impenetrable Black Wall. Mercenaries. Let's say you've got a serious problem, it just so happens you'd rather not get the police involved, nor your buddies at the Corp who usually deal with this stuff. Maybe you were directly responsible for a shipment that mysteriously disappeared, or you'd like to see someone else's shipment disappear. Someone knows too much about you, someone chose to work for the wrong Corp, or maybe someone has suddenly become no longer necessary. In that case, you need someone to handle things for you, a techie, solo, netrunner, or someone with more specialized skills. You need a mercenary. That's when they call the A-team. Mercs typically work... Well, how's that go? See you? The A-team. Maybe you need the A-team, some of that. Mercs typically work with fixers, a go-between who slap together a team of pros with the right skills for the client. Fixers will take care of all the messy intricacies of dirty biz. You won't even have to meet the merc doing it for you. That's what you want. The job will get done quickly and discreetly, for the right price, of course. Most mercs out on the street taking whatever comes their way until they can catch a fixer's... Most mercs start out on the street taking whatever comes their way until they can catch a fixer's attention. Only a few of them end up like Morgan Blackhand or Andrew Boo Boo Wayland. That is to say, legends. Militech. Militech International Armaments is one of the largest, most powerful corporations in the world. Known mainly in the NUSA for their support of the federal government, they provide both manpower and arms to the regime, including weapons and specialist military gear. Militech's contract for the NUSA is controversial in some political circles. Militech has been accused of attempting to create a monopoly, while the clear connections between Militech's CEO and current NUSA President Rosalind Myers and the corporation's board have only exacerbated corporate and diplomatic tensions. Militech also operates in the private sector, providing security as well as defensive and offensive combat services. The corporation offers clients the latest equipment, skilled staff, and trained, well-equipped agents to get the job done. In addition, the Megacorp also develops and produces its own firearms, drones, implants, even vehicles suitable for land, air, and sea combat. Maelstrom. A gang that controls the districts of Watson and the Northside Industrial District, NID. You can easily recognize them by their intimidating faceplates and hostile optic implants, which not only indicates their gang affiliation, but they're also their fetishization of cyberware and cyber modification. Looking at Maelstrom, you might think, now those are some hella bold pioneers of transhumanism. If they were only testing the limits of the human bodies on themselves, then you'd be right. Sadly, they also like to conduct experiments on those unfortunate enough to cross their path. Maelstrom is known for their exceptionally brutal and public gang executions. Combine that with illegal brain dance production and a manic fighting style, and you've got yourself a gang with a reputation as a band of lunatics on the verge of cyberpsychosis. The truth is, there's nothing crazy about how Maelstrom operates. At the end of the day, it's all about biz, and the more rumors there are about them, the better. There's a lot of entries. I might just read all this and end the episode like this. I don't know. Relic. Secure your soul. Relic is an interface and component of Arasaka's experimental flagship project, publicly known as Secure Your Soul. It uses the concept of personality transferal by converting the data in the human nervous system into a digitized engram that and stored as a construct on the Relic biochip. The purpose of Secure Your Soul is the ability, currently only available to the wealthiest clients, to communicate with deceased loved ones. Their personality constructs, which are preserved on the Relic biochip, mean that in practice, death is no longer the ultimate barrier. However, it doesn't take a genius to realize that the potential for the Relic technology is much higher. Arasaka currently is not sharing any information on its further plans for the program. Braindance. As Braindance's popularity spread, public opinion divided into two camps, those who saw the new technology as a revelation and those who saw it as a threat. Some predicted Braindance would save humanity as we know it, bringing an end to unnecessary conflict and ushering us into a new utopian age of mutual understanding and respect. After all, the argument went, if you look at yourself from your enemy's point of view, if you understand him deeply and vice versa, he ceases to be your enemy. Others, however, foresaw a wave of new addictions, deepening isolation and societal division, even a crisis of identity. In the end, the market proved both views right. Braindance became an everyday product, another form of entertainment, but also a new form of surveillance. In essence, braindance is a transfer of the conscious experiences of the person who recorded or scrolled them to the one who relives them. The raw material must first be processed or edited before it can be used. The Mox. The youngest established gang in Night City, its beginnings date back to 2067 when the murder of a sex worker sparked riots that lasted days. The gang formed out of the protesters attracted many others to its ranks for years after. The Mox is a motley crew of current and former sex workers, punks, freaks, and all kinds of outcasts. The gang's main headquarters is Lizzie's Bar, a braindance club that served as the Mox's main source of income. The gang's aesthetic is characterized by aggressive kitsch, loud colors, plastic, and latex. It's a very colorful gang. Artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence began as simple algorithms meant to simplify our lives. With time, some became convincingly capable of simulating humans who programmed personalities one could even grow to like. They were also weaponized AIs, essentially military technology used to break through enemy security in the net. But then Netrunner Raish Bartmas arrived on the scene, and with him the infamous data crash. Bartmas's target was the corporate data fortresses. His goal, to steal the data held within and unleash it into the net. What he achieved was a full-blown war that would transform cyberspace for good. As a direct result, AIs began to mutate, becoming deadly dangerous. Thus, rogue AIs were born. At that point, Netwatch runners were forced to design the Black Wall, a powerful artificial intelligence with one job, keep the rogue AIs out of the remnants of the net that survived the crash. Officially, nobody ever ventures beyond the Black Wall. Unofficially, well, believe what you like. Kang Tao. Kang Tao is a Chinese company and one of the world's largest weapons manufacturers. For years now, Kang Tao has increasingly become a worthy competitor for Arisaka by introducing some of the most bleeding-edge technology the market has ever seen. The megacorp consistently surpasses client expectations for quality weapons and equipment that suits both military and paramilitary needs. But most noticeably, Kang Tao is widely recognized for its specialization in the development, and production of smart class weaponry and weapon systems. In this niche market, they are without equal. Sixth Street. After the Fourth Corporate War, a large number of career soldiers were left without jobs or prospects. The most enterprising of them formed the Sixth Street Gang. Not only do they boast veterans among their ranks, but also ex-police officers, former corporate security agents, and civilians who have had a crash course in combat training. Everyone and anyone who wants to bring order to this town. The end justifies the means, and the means usually involve robberies, extortion, arms dealing, and stealing cars. Their main turf is in Arroyo, but Sixth Street's garages and bases of operation can also be found in other parts of the city. Rates. The first and new Nomad codes elaborate the various reasons you might be expelled from your family, including share with others in your clan, or do not keep for yourself that which may help another in your clan. Reading those documents today, it's hard to fight the feeling that they were written in different, happier times. These days, nomads are more often expelled from their families for murdering or raping a family fellow member, human trafficking, poisoning the water supply, or betrayal of the clan, and we have a word for those nomads, the Raffin Shiv. Once ousted, most Raffin still maintain their nomadic lifestyles. They form larger groups on the road, but nobody would call these groups family, not even in jest. The Raffin Shiv prowl the Badlands, ambushing unsuspecting travelers, corpo convoys, or even, and with particular relish, other nomad camps. A gang of Raffin Shiv formed outside Night City's gates, the Wraiths. They're well-organized, effective, and willing to do anything. After all, like all Raffins, they've got nothing to lose. Tiger Claws. Night City is a melting pot of cultures and ethnicities. Even when it comes to its Asian demographic, the Chinese and Japanese influence is unmistakable, as are the Tiger Claws. As a gang, the Tiger Claws are well-organized, efficient, and savvy, but also unpredictable. Their business decisions are purely rational, but when it comes to their enemies or to a disloyal gang member, their methods can be shocking. The Tiger Claws mainly operate out of Japantown, Little China, Kambuki, and Charter Hill. Their main source of income are nightclubs, casinos, and braindance bars. Night citizens love to have a good time. No other gang knows how to capitalize on that better than the Tigers. Doll Chip. Originally created in a military lab, the Doll Chip found its true calling in the entertainment industry, specifically the sex industry. It is comprised of three main functions, importing data from systems, steering the doll's behavior in session, and wiping the doll's memory after each and every session. The last function has turned out to be very attractive to applicants looking to work in dollhouses. Clients are also on board. The dolls are completely unaware of what happens to them during the session, giving clients absolute freedom and discretion. It's a win-win, right? I would never want to do anything like that. I wouldn't want to do that and then have my memory wiped, so yeah, double trouble. Illegal brain dance. Illegal brain dances, or XBDs, arrived on the black market almost as soon as brain dance recording technology became publicly available. Rare fetishes, violence, sadomasochistic fantasies, and even death are the most common motifs in XBDs. These brain dances are scrolled in secret, usually by force, and are rarely edited. Reliving such recordings can cause nausea, epileptic seizures, or, in extreme cases, even death. XBDs have their own regular group of viewers. Demand for the type for the scrolls demands as high as ever, meaning new producers are continually arriving on the scene. Some have even managed to form their own well-known brands and continue to push the limits of what's possible, albeit morally reprehensible. Animals. Oh, though we're talking about actual animals. Nope. Unlike other Night City gangs, the animals don't have a defined territory. You can find them almost everywhere, but you know, it's not like people go out looking for them. The animals aren't a centralized gang. They're divided into smaller groups led by independent alphas, males or females. The concrete jungle. For the animals, it's not just a pretentious metaphor. From their hormone-pumping, beast-inducing implants to their love of street combat, the animals are obsessed with the wild side of human nature. Their physical strength and proficiency in various martial arts, and their sheer size alone, make animals the ideal security guards and bouncers for clubs and bars. Besides that, the animals are known for their illegal brawls, hijacking transports, and their addiction to juice, their very own homemade hormone cocktail. Mikoshi. Mikoshi is one of the most heavily guarded data fortresses in Arasaka and holds the digitized minds of clients from the Secure Your Soul program. For security reasons, information about the program is still classified by the corporation, and the physical location of Mikoshi is a closely guarded secret. Together, the smattering of access points nested in cyberspace. Secret together. Among netrunners who have breached Arasaka, there's a widespread belief that Mikoshi is a soul prison for the digitized victims of Soul Killer. Rumor has it that Arasaka uses the souls of captured netrunners to use them as data collectors, but so far no one has been able to verify this. Solo. Soldier, corporate bodyguard, cyber ninja, they call themselves whatever they want, but to the rest of the world, they're simply solos. Solos are mercenaries that specialize in combat skills, whether on the battlefield or as a private hustle, hired muscle. They'll fight for corporate or government armies, private security companies, criminal organizations, even the police, but most prefer to earn their eddies on shorter-term jobs. We live in increasingly trying times, so solos have no shortage of opportunities. It's guaranteed work in a still-growing industry, but it does have its dark side. Every professional solo needs to keep up with trends and new tech and invest in better equipment, weapons, cyberware, gadgets, and supplements, which will ensure they stay smarter, faster, and stronger than their opponents. But they must also remain vigilant, as this push for progress can cross a line from which there is no return. According to official MaxTac data, solos are the largest demographic in confirmed cyberpsychosis cases. Hold on a second. Aldecaldos. One of the oldest nomad nations founded by Juan Aldecaldo, who fought a ruthless war at the tail end of the 1990s against the gangs ruling L.A. He formed a neighborhood watch, which numbered 5,000 people by the time it left the city, and was known for its emphasis on family values, in whose name Juan launched his uprising against ineffective police and corrupt media. The Aldecaldos currently consist of a few dozen families spread out around America that are constantly on the move. Petrochem. Our planet's moving forward thanks to Petrochem. That commercial slogan is only half exaggerated. Thanks to its partnership with the bioengineering corporation Biotechnica, Petrochem converts genetically modified wheat grown on Biotechnica's millions of acres of farmland into the biofuel of the future. CHOOH2. In addition, it also has limited rights to grow its own modified grain. That means nobody can entirely avoid Petrochem, though while their influence and resources shouldn't be overstated, their competitors are fully aware of Petrochem's economic and political power. If the megacorporation were able to monopolize fuel production in the country, Petrochem would call the shots on everything. That's why the corp doesn't skimp on its security, hiring the best industry counterintel specialists and always stationed on high alert. An attack could come from anywhere and at any time. Rocker Boy. A class of 21st century rebels who turned their music into a weapon and aimed it at corporations and the powers that be. They're unruly artists, street heroes, charismatic frontmen, firing up thousands of fans at concerts that usually end in riots. Their uncompromising attitude, politically radical lyrics and performances has granted them their own sociological status. Their fingers are dexterous, or as dexterous on the frets as they are on their triggers, when words and music aren't enough to get their message across. Johnny Silverhand set the bar for Rocker Boys, and not much has changed 50 years after his mysterious death. Rocker Boys are still screaming their throats bloody about oppression by the system, though there are some, like Carrie Eurodyne, who were accused of selling out and abandoning post-punk rock disobedience for money and fame. Even if that were true, the world still needs its musical revolutionaries, and they're still among us. Maybe they're just starting to compose their first Screw You songs, or maybe they're about to stumble out of a seedy dive and throw down the gauntlet to the corpse and the badges, but when they finally start making noise, that's when people start to listen. Techies. You see a few odd nuts and bolts or scraps of metal, a good techie sees a work of art. You press a button and the device just works. A techie knows how, why and how to make it work better. Techies are the sort to cut their teeth on tech by taking it apart and putting it back together. They open an electric panel and not only know how to shut off the power, but also send an elevator to a specific floor, reconnect alarm systems, or control a military bot from a safe remote distance. They're also needed wherever hardware meets soft, Braindance editing being one common example. Techies know it's not enough to have all the ones and zeros in the right place. You need something to feed the code into. They can calibrate implants with ease, understand the pages and pages of minute specifications, and use this knowledge to their advantage. Most people think they don't need a techie, that their once-a-month Ripper Doc tune-ups are more than enough, that they've got their back against a wall, bombs are exploding next door, and pop, something breaks. Suddenly, a techie seems handy indeed. Voodoo Boys. Okay. Netwatch. Netwatch was founded as a European net security company, but its success quickly transformed it into an international agency sponsored by corporations. The Net Police specializes in securing data fortresses, pursuing unlicensed AIs, neutralizing hacks, removing software threats, and apprehending troublesome netrunners. Netwatch also maintains the Black Wall, a barrier of ice that guards against rogue post-crash AIs. Corporate propaganda likes to portray Netwatch agents as defenders of humanity, without which the net would have long ago collapsed. The truth is that it's not so hard to become a public enemy in the eyes of Netwatch. Go ahead, jack in, and read the security protocols sent to every user on a net. The moment you step off the line, or over the line, some eager rookie in the nearest Netwatch division will have a file on you in no time. Gendachi. the roots of the Kandachi Corporation, or rather Kenshiri Adachi Armaments, harken back to the 16th century, when the Japanese Kenshiri family established themselves as a blacksmithing clan. Well, I wouldn't think of Japanese as being blacksmiths, but I guess, yeah, they have to be to make those samurai swords and stuff, right? The corporation took on its final form in the 21st century after merging with the Adachi Company. These days, Kandachi is known for its reliable mono weapons made in factories in low Earth orbit. In fact, such products have become synonymous with the brand, utterly terrifying in a skilled solo's hands. These must-have blades are responsible for the Japanese corporation's success. Current CEO Tesha Yokoi is known for his keen business sense, deep knowledge of kendo, and short fuse. Occasionally, he has been known to deal with his enemies himself, using his own corporation's indispensable mono weapons, of course. You'd be hard-pressed to find a better endorsement. SciTech. Short and sweet. SciTech is a technology and biotechnology company specializing in implants and cybernetic prostheses. SciTech is known for its high-quality products, all patented solutions developed in-house at the corporation's labs. Glitter. Glitter is a highly addictive psychedelic drug and recent arrival on Night City's streets. The new substance quickly drew Night City's full attention. First, it's truly strong stuff, even for the booster and brain dance glutted residents of Night City. Second, glitter's illegal, immediately giving it the irresistible aura of forbidden fruit. Finally, glitter kills. One off dose or weak nervous system, and glitter will have those neurons firing white hot, hence the name, perhaps. Death is inevitable. Wildlife in Night City. Animals are a rare sight in Night City, but it wasn't always like that. Once upon a time, you can hear the cries of seagulls at the marina, swat your way through swarms of flies at the bazaar, and best of all, step in dog crap at the park. Best of all? Everything changed in the second half of the 21st century when the city was brought to a standstill by animal-borne diseases. In 2051, 7,000 victims, 2058, 10,000, 2061, 12,000. The Panic City Council decided to eliminate all birds in the city, while exterminators started using military equipment for traps and fumigation. Personal pets could be kept, though owners were saddled with huge tax bills. Oh, God. Poor animals. Hey, we're almost done. Revere Courier Services. Revere Courier Services is a shipping corporation that operates on all continents, providing transport services for both commercial and individual clients. Their fleet consists of armored trucks, freighters, and aircraft capable of carrying high-value cargo. But the RCS pledge states that all cargo is sacred, whether it's luxury limousine destined for an African billionaire's estate, or a care package of moon cheese and banana butter bears a grandmother from Vista del Rey sent her grandson for Valentine's Day. While the limo would be transported on a massive freighter and the box of treats by scooter delivery, they both have one thing in common. They'll arrive in the right hands. Of course, RCS cannot give their full guarantee, as the shipping industry is a major target of piracy and theft. Still, in such cases, the company offers full compensation for stolen goods. Some of RCS's largest shipping vessels are protected by outsourced security, often mercenaries, whose presence is often deterrent enough for would-be aggressors. A vital service offered by RCS is physical data transfers for data that's too precious to upload to the net. Data couriers number among the most experienced professionals, and damage or loss of shipment almost never occurs. Cyberpsychosis. Oh, look at that scene. As the trauma team medical docs define it, cyberpsychosis is a collective term for all psychotic and anxiety-related personality disorders caused by hardware implanted in the body and any and all behavioral mods, including software. We all know someone whose neighbor took the chrome a little too far, then left home one day with a gun and opened fire in a crowd. Or maybe said neighbor didn't want to cough up the cred for a good ripper, so he started suffering from nightmares and hearing voices once the hormone blockers were in, then lost it. Some call cyberpsychosis a disease wrought by social inequality. Others say it's the price to be paid for an unhealthy love of technology. Still others claim it's complete BS. That is, until their neighbor is shooting up the hood and their fingers dialing max tack. Unification War, Metal War. Yes, I always found this rather interesting. The Unification War, or sometimes called the Metal Wars, that's the same thing, was a series of armed conflicts spanning from January 2069 to June 2070. It was fought by the NUSA, New United States of America, and the Free States, supported by Militech and Arasaka, respectively. The conflict's name differs depending on who you ask. NUSA Militech supporters call it the Unification War, whereas Arasaka Corp and certain Free States have preferred the name Metal Wars. North California, NorCal, stood on the side of the Free States, while South California, SoCal, stood by the NUSA. Note, Night City remained independent throughout the conflict. The war was finally concluded by a ceasefire signed in Arvin, SoCal. However, both sides declared victory for themselves and found the terms of the peace largely unsatisfactory, causing many to believe the outbreak of another armed conflict is only a matter of time. The Free States were obliged to forfeit their independent status, albeit only on paper, as they would remain autonomous in practice. Ultimately, the NUSA choose to accept the conditions of this peaceful resolution rather than risk escalation of the war across the globe, resulting in potentially millions of casualties and, more importantly, a deep recession. Arasaka and Militech suffered heavier losses than any other corporation or government body involved in the conflicts. Both megacorps lost billions of euro dollars in military equipment, and because Militech had their own boots on the ground, they additionally lost the lives of thousands of soldiers whom they staunchly referred to as independent consultants. The Arasaka headquarters bombing. The only indisputable fact in this story is the date, 20th August 2023. The day a nuclear explosion obliterated Corporal Plaza and a large chunk of city center. The rest is pure speculation, gossip, lies, and conspiracy theories, all the way from the number of casualties to those responsible for the attack. The most famous version, widely disseminated by corporate PR machines and trickled down through the media, tells of an unidentified terrorist group that was responsible for an armed assault on Arasaka Tower, followed by the explosion. Really? They don't know it's Johnny Silverhand and friends? But does anyone really take corporate press releases seriously anymore? Take some of the more intriguing theories circulating on the streets today. That was an inside job in an attempt to escalate the conflict between Arasaka and Militech, followed by an elaborately orchestrated cover-up, or the results of a failed experiment that spiraled out of control in a secret lab somewhere under Arasaka Tower. How much of it is true? Most likely we'll never find out, and even if we did, it wouldn't bring back the victims of the tragedy. Combat Cab. In the city, sounds like a comic book series. Combat Cab. Or a movie. In a city overrun with gang violence, shootings, and cyber psycho attacks, security is at a premium. Anyone traveling to, or more likely passing through, the city's sketchiest neighborhoods always dial the number for Combat Cab. As detailed on their site, Combat Cab's fleet of heavily armored vehicles can protect passengers from all weapons across the caliber spectrum. The fact that they are the only transportation company operating within the combat zone should speak for itself. In recent years, the Delamain cab service has risen to claim the top market share in the heart of the city, but public data terms financed by Combat Cab can still be found. North California. Since the end of the Unification War, North California has struggled to lead the Free States in their opposition to the NUSA's agenda for reintegration. As a leader in the worlds of finance and biotech, NorCal maintains one of the largest armed forces of any Free State. However, even their substantial might is too little to challenge the federal government in open conflict. Instead, NorCal leadership stations its forces along the border, with the highest concentrations of troops being placed on the border with South California, a state which has declared its allegiance to the NUSA government. And finally, for this video, because we've been running for over an hour, Valentino's. Killed some of them recently. Loud vests, flashy gold cyberware, heavy jewelry, tattoos of Santa Muerte and Jesus Malaverde, I'm guessing, You would have a hard time mistaking a Valentino when you saw one. Inspired by Chicano culture, their expressive style makes them seem like something straight out of a Mexican barrio. But if you look closer, you'll see anyone can join the gang, no matter their background or ethnicity. The Valentinos are strictly territorial, operating in Haywood. They're tied to the local community by nearly familial bonds of friendship and by biz. The Valentinos run completely legal businesses like restaurants, nightclubs, and auto shops, but all are fronts for the other dirtier biz of money laundering, smuggling stolen vehicles or guns, human trafficking, and gang warfare. The Valentinos' friendship is priceless, and it will follow you to the grave, so you might want to think twice before riding with them. Alright, so I think I'll do another video for now. I mean, this stuff we're not going to read, obviously. Just clearing stuff out. Quick hacks. This is how to do it. Character stuff. Street cred. Encrypted chars. Okay. So, yeah, I'm going to do another video reading through locations, the city and surrounding areas, fixers, districts, sub-districts, vendor hubs, more fixers, other characters, and story characters. So I'm not sure if it's going to be in one video. There's a lot to read. But we'll at least start with, I know we'll have at least locations in city and surrounding areas. There's not too many of those. Fixers, I might just switch to the other fixer. I don't know why there's two different fixer categories here. But that'll be next episode. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you next time. And always, seek adventure.